Hey, thank you for taking time to watch this sermon. We have prayed that you'd be blessed by it. We want you to know, too, we believe that this is really supplemental to your experience in the life of a local church. But if you're here in the Dallas area, we hope you'll come and join us and be with us for worship. We pray this blesses your life and you're drawn closer to Christ as a result of this message.
Well, you can see that we're in a series of messages. If you're a guest today, I know we have a lot of families who are here with, I think there were, 250 babies, and that was outstanding. And we're so glad that you're here. Many of you are from out of town, and then others of you are here for the first time. And we're so glad that you're here. Some of you, if you feel like outsiders today, we want you to know that you are welcome here. That there are those who are members, yes, and even members of the family of God. There are those who are outsiders, but we hope that you have already been welcomed in and loved into our church family today. We hope you'll come back. I'm going to start with an email that was given by permission from one of our members, an email from one of his best friends, young adult in our church. We'll call this guy John. He says this, John says, although I have never been a true believer, I used to be on the fence, at least. I get the community aspect of church and the fact that faith provides a little guidance and stability among the chaos of life. So many things seem so unfair and unexplainable. But with faith, there is an answer because believers can always believe it is part of God's plan. It provides comfort. I get it. And I would never try to talk anyone out of it. And then he goes on. But nowadays, I've found myself further from giving it a chance than ever before. And then he goes on to share with this friend, close friend, a member of our church. He goes on to say, to talk about the hypocrisy that he sees in the church, the immorality and the immaturity of politicians that are often associated with conservative Christian views. He said he's seen that more and more in these days, and he is finding himself further and further away from the truth. So what do we do? How would this friend respond to him? And I'll tell you that he has, and he did, and he responded with great love. He got with him that week and spent time with him. It's a loving relationship out of which this email comes. And then he offered another email in the end, a very direct email to talk about how that we will all appear before the judgment seat of Christ someday. And with all the barriers and struggles that he has, and don't look to others to confirm your faith or not as much as you look at the truth of God. And he told him that we're all going to stand before Christ someday, and what matters is if you're ready or not. But a lot of us have barriers to faith, and a lot of friends that we have barriers to faith. And it's a challenging time in our culture. So what we're doing throughout this month is helping us all, each one of us, very practical sermon today. And I would say, frankly, this sermon is more for insiders. This sermon is more for those who already have received Christ. And I'm not going to presume that all of us have. So if you have not, again, you're in a safe place to journey with us and to ask questions as we seek to be loving and kind and on this journey with you. We'd like nothing more than to lead you to faith in Christ. I want you to turn to Colossians chapter 4. Beginning with verse 5 and 6, would you turn there, Colossians 4, in your Bible. You can have your Bible open there before you. But I'm going to read this passage of Scripture with you. And I'm going to jump around a little bit to other passages of Scripture. But I want us to turn there. Go ahead and you'll see it there on the screen. In fact, in the ESV, I want you to look at this. And let's read this verse together. All right? This is Paul's word to the church in Colossae, echoes forth into our church today. And he says this, let's all read it together. Walk in wisdom toward outsiders, making the best use of the time. Let your speech always be gracious, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how you ought to answer each person. Now, I think there's probably never been a time in my lifetime, we talk about this often, when there is a need for greater civility, greater kindness, greater respect, even while disagreeing, than there is in our day. And I believe that God is setting us up as his ambassadors, as witnesses, to bridge the gap that seems so far for so many people. The outsiders that Paul is referring to here are those who are not yet in the family of God. They've not yet received Christ. So these are people who are far from God. In a pluralistic society, those who saw the gospel as this brand new thing, very contrary to the way that they were living. So it was not that they were met with open arms, believers, during that day. And so I think we find ourselves, even like in our day, now more and more a pluralistic society, a group in our culture who did not grow up in the church and who don't have a history, a muscle memory, if you will, a spiritual memory of the gospel, of a Judeo-Christian worldview, even though clearly that's the foundations of our country and the way that we believe and think here in the global West. But you know, outsiders are much in the news nowadays, aren't they? I mean, literally, those who are outside from outside of our country, whether it be immigrants or refugees. And you need to know as a church family that we have ministry among those who are already here. We're going to leave the vetting and the security of our nation to our governmental leaders and our military. But we know that we've been called to serve and to love those who find themselves in great need. And there's not a more vulnerable bunch among us than those who are just a few miles away from our church in the Vickery Meadow area. Some of you know, just on the other side of 75, we're involved in a ministry, have been for a long time, where we're serving immigrants and, yes, refugees. It's the most highly concentrated population of immigrants and refugees, one of the highest in the country. And I believe that God has set us here not too far away to serve those in need. So ministry champions like Terry Hurd, many of you know Terry, member of our church, involved there. And if you want to know more about how you can get involved, you call our mission office. I wanted you to know that this week, in fact, on Thursday, we're holding a citywide forum here in our church in the Great Hall from noon to 2, a forum on refugee and immigrant care from noon to 2. You can come and learn. There's going to be city leaders and others who will be here, nonprofits and service organizations, so we can learn how we can serve and get accurate information and what is the vetting process and all of that. But it's mostly about how you can get involved and how we can serve together as we seek to lead the way as a church family. So I'm so proud of you, us, our church family, for leading the way to being like Jesus, the hands and feet of Christ. Terry Hurd would tell you that she was driving here to church from Lake Highlands, going right through that neighborhood essentially for many years, until God prompted her, laid it on her heart to actually get involved and do something. And she'd tell you now that her life has been transformed forever. She would describe her life now as a Christian, where formerly it might have been boring at times or maybe a little bit lackluster, didn't have this great adventure of life. She would say now her Christian faith, her life, her witness is one of great adventure every day. She doesn't know what's going to happen next. She told me, Jeff, I believe that not all of us can go to the nations. We can give and we can go. But she said, I believe that God's bringing the nations to us right here. Right here in a neighborhood not far away. And she said, I've been called to serve them and share the gospel. And others of you have joined her, but many more need to do so. I wonder how you'd describe your Christian life in these days. If you were honest, would you describe it as a great, exciting adventure? Or would you describe it as boring? Kind of rote. You know, many of us, maybe we find ourselves that way. And no wonder that, frankly, our lives in Christ are not so compelling, not winsome or exciting for others from outsiders looking in. I think what we need is what Thomas Chalmers, the great Scottish preacher from the 1800s, called the explosive power of a new affection. Many of us need a revival in our hearts. But what's going to happen there, we can pray for revival all day long, but until we take steps of faith, we're not going to see the power of God show up in our lives. You need the explosive power of a new affection in your life to get out of this boring kind of a Christian life. When you step into the great adventure of sharing your faith with other people, determining you're going to look and watch for people who do not yet know the Lord, I promise you, you're going to enter into the great adventure, and your life with Christ will be anything but boring. I don't know a person who follows Christ and seeks to share the gospel in their daily lives that would describe their Christian life as boring. Not one. And as I've entered into looking for opportunities to share my faith in the community and with people that I encounter, I can tell you, you don't know what's going to happen next. And God sends us into this great adventure. I want you to consider the time that you first came to faith in Christ. I want you to think back on the day. Maybe it's a process for you, a moment in time perhaps, where you remember the person who shared the gospel with you. Stop and rejoice those who influenced your life. And I want you to consider what it was like to hear when the light came on for you for the very first time. If you're like me, I came to faith when I was a child, and there have been moments where the light came on. I had a grace awakening where I realized more fully what I did. I think that happens. Most often coming to Christ is a process. I want you to think about what it would be like to hear, to physically hear for the first time. What would that be like? We now have technology that helps people who have not heard a thing, lived in a world of silence until technology made it available for them to have the opportunity to hear for the first time. Watch this.
Recording. Welcome.
First hearing aid.
Are you ready?
No.
Okay. This is the big moment. You're going to hear something. We don't really know what.
I'm going to hold silent, pushing your head just a little bit.
There you go. It's creeping. So now technically your device is on. Can you tell?
Did
you hear it?
Hey, I sound.
You're hearing yourself better.
Okay, you can try. It's okay.
Hi, Cooper.
Munchkin,
but do I sound like one
now? Can you imagine? Can you imagine? And yet you and I have the opportunity to help people hear with the heart. Not just simply hear audibly, but to step across a line spiritually into eternity. You and I have the great news. We have the opportunity to be a part of that moment when someone comes to faith. Wouldn't you love to have that job, to be that technician? I mean, I look across, many of you are wiping tears from your eyes because you're going, oh my gosh, that would be amazing. And yet you and I have the opportunity to help people hear the good news for the first time. That is a life of adventure. Here's what Paul says. In fact, in Romans chapter 10, you can turn there. Romans 10, verses 14 through 17. In Romans 10, you can maybe keep a finger on Colossians. We're going to stay there. I'm going to walk through that just a little bit there. But I want to go quickly through a challenge for you and help open your understanding, open your mind, for you to see how you can be a part of sharing the good news with others. And in Romans 10, verses 14 through 17, Listen to this. How then will they call on him whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe in him of whom they have never heard? And how are they to hear without someone preaching? And how are they to preach unless they are sent? Hold on to that word. As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the good news. But they have not all obeyed the gospel. For Isaiah says, Lord, who has believed what he has heard from us? And then Paul summarizes all this by saying, so faith comes from hearing, and hearing through the word of Christ. Okay, so the word of Christ is the gospel, and it comes as good news. That's what it is. Euangelion is this word, gospel, and it literally means good news. But good news, as we say often, needs a newscaster. It needs someone who speaks it. It needs someone who is doing the preaching. And preaching is much more than what takes place from a pulpit. I remember when my kids were younger and we'd be at dinner, or maybe I'd get home and they had good news from the day. They found out something or discovered something at school, or one of them had good news. And when one entered into talking about it, they would argue over who got to tell the good news. No, that's my story. Well, no, that happened to me. I'll tell him. And I remember they'd argue over who got to share the good news. Why? Because there's great joy in being the one who gets to share the good news. I tell you, I'd love to have that job. Be a technician that gets to help people hear for the first time. Perhaps every day they could be a part of something like that. You and I get to do that. We get to experience the joy of bringing others to faith in Christ. I love what it says in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 1 through 3. It reminds us that all of this starts with love. If I speak in the tongues of men and angels, but have not love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, if I have all faith so as to move mountains, but have not love, I'm nothing. If I give away all I have, if I deliver up my body to be burned, if I offer myself the ultimate sacrifice of my own life, but if I do not love, I gain nothing. And so Paul tells us in Colossians 4, he says, walk in a way that's wise. Be thoughtful towards outsiders in the way that you live. Making the best use of your time. Have this sense of urgency. Look for opportunities with others who may or may not know the Lord. And let your speech be gracious. That is to be grace-filled. And love in a way that would lead them to Christ. Let your speech be seasoned with salt so that you might be able to reach and to draw others to Christ. But it all happens out of love. You and I are sent into our spheres of influence, into our families, into the workplace, with friends that you have. And my hope is, I'm sharing with you today, you're thinking of people that you know who need to know Christ. You're thinking of people that you can be praying for. God has placed them in your life, not by accident, but so that you might reach them for Him. Charles Spurgeon is the one who said, every Christian is either a missionary or an imposter. We all have good news to share. We need to think like missionaries. Well, how does a missionary think? Well, when we head off into the city or work with our mission partners around the world, literally, we're heading to South Texas on several mission trips here in the spring into the summer. Stacy and I will be going with young couples in our church, going to South Texas in a couple of months. Many of you have joined us in Guatemala or in India. Some of you, I'm looking across the room here, been to Cuba, Cambodia, or Bangladesh. And our strategy is always this. We call it the ministry cycle. You can see it there. It always starts with this life of worship, our love for God because He's loved us. So we love all people. That's why we go. But we look at what it means to be compassionate, to find a particular need that needs to be met in that place. But we do so to express our love for God and care for them, which leads to relationship. We don't just swoop in and out. We have long-term partners, and we seek to have vetted high-integrity partners in these places. on the ground, where we have a relationship that leads then to sharing the gospel, evangelism. And then that leads us to discipleship, because we're not called to make converts, we're called to make disciples. So I want to ask you, do you think this way in your daily life as a Christian? Are you living on mission? Are you living this way in your daily life? You know, it's true. The old adage, people won't care how much you know until you know, till they know how much you care. I wonder if people in your life know how much you care. What I've discovered is many of us don't share our faith. And I think there's a reason for that. And I want to break down some barriers today and in the next couple of weeks. I think many of us, we have a view of evangelists. And we think about it, we say, well, I'm not an evangelist. I'll leave that to Jeff. I'll leave that to others. I think we have two options. And this is what I want to talk about today. I think something's going to really open up your mind and your heart, give you greater confidence and passion in sharing your faith. You see, many of us think of an evangelist and we think, well, we have negative ideas about an evangelist. Pushy, arrogant, fake. Some of us think of the televangelist, right? I could never be a televangelist. I don't have the hair for the televangelist. And you know, many years ago, there was a book that came out. It was called The Day America Told the Truth, a national survey that ranked professions from top to bottom regarding the honesty and integrity of that particular occupation. And you can imagine the televangelist was right at the bottom, just two below the bottom of 72 occupations. The televangelist ranked below lawyers. Sorry, below attorneys. The televangelist found himself below politicians, even prostitutes. Only organized crime bosses and drug dealers found themselves below the televangelist. And so we think of that and we think, I don't want to be that. None of us want to be that. But then we think on the positive side of the ledger, and many of us think of an evangelist as someone like Billy Graham, perhaps. And we think, not that either. And so we conclude, I'm not an evangelist. Now listen, because we have these different thoughts, presuppositions about what it is to be an evangelist, many of us have decided, I'm not one. Friends, listen, if you've received Christ, you are. To say you're not an evangelist is to say, I'm not a good news teller. Because the gospel is news, and it needs a newscaster. It needs someone who's ready. Notice that Paul even notes in Colossians 4, he says, let your speech, the gospel is news, it's something that's shared, right? I love the story of Dwight L. Moody, the great American pastor, preacher. Was in Chicago in the 1800s. He was a fiery evangelist with fervent passion for evangelism, and he saw thousands upon thousands come to Christ across America and even in England, where he was involved in these crusades, and he'd go around preaching. And a woman came to him at his church in Chicago and said that she didn't like his style. He just too direct and maybe too passionate for her. And he talked to her and he asked her, well, what's your style? And as they talked, he realized she didn't have a style. She said, well, I don't really share my faith. And he said, I like my way better than yours. See, many of us are not sharing our faith because we don't feel that we're prepared. I'd argue that what we need more than anything is the explosive power of a new affection for Christ. A reminder of the gospel and what he's done in our lives. Because when you're undone by the gospel and what Christ has done for you, you can't help but share it with others. Ours is not a problem of training and preparation. Ours is a love problem. Ours is a faith problem. It's the only way that my mind can go when I think about my own life or yours. Why do we not share the gospel as we should? But I would like to help us break down some barriers. So very practical sermon to close, and then over the next couple of weeks, we're going to unpack much of what I want to talk about here today. I want to ask you, if it's not one of those, if it's not the televangelist, and it's not Billy Graham, praise God for Billy Graham, then what's your style? Because we all have a style. You've been created in a way for God to use you to reach others for Christ. I would say it this way. The premise is it takes all kinds of Christians to reach all kinds of non-Christians. That's how God's designed us. Sharing Christ with others is a team sport. That's the beauty of the church. It's not unlike a golf bag where you can look in and grab a certain club for a certain lie or a certain shot. Some are like the driver. Some are really direct. Hit the ball hard, and it's going to come right at you, in your face. Here's the gospel. Others are going to be more kind of a finesse approach. They're going to find ways to get people out of the rough. But if the ball is the gospel, we're all seeking to get it into the hearts of people who do not yet know him. And here's what I think will be a mind-opening kind of a thought for you to help you be more confident in your witness and in being a light for Christ. I want you to think with me real quick. Six different styles that we're going to unpack over the next few weeks. First one is the direct style. This is a person who's confident and assertive. I would say Peter is a good example in the Bible. You know, Peter was very impetuous, in fact. He was kind of a ready, fire, aim kind of guy. Getting himself in trouble often, but God used him as he was so direct and so confident. Some of you are that way. Others are more of like the intellectual style. This is a person who's inquisitive, analytical, logical, and this would be like Paul. He was one of the brightest minds that has ever lived. We find him at Mars Hill. He loved talking to others who didn't know exactly what the gospel was. He loved doing that, helping break down barriers. Josh McDowell would be a kind of a contemporary example, or N.T. Wright or Tim Keller, some of you may know. By the way, Josh is going to be here in May to preach and to speak, and we're asking him to even tell his story, coming from as an atheist to a believer, now an apologist. Well, thirdly is the testimonial style. And I think of the blind man in John 9, who they asked, is he the Son of God? Do you believe he was the Savior? And the blind man said, well, I don't know. I don't know the answers to all that. All I know is here's what happened to me. This is the beauty. Every one of us have this style who've come to faith. You have a story to tell. And no one can argue with your story. They can say, well, that didn't happen to me. But they can't argue with your personal experience. Not really. And so we think of people like Corrie Ten Boom of a generation past, or Lee Strobel, who we recently heard from here at our church, or the I Am Second, you know, website, testimony, stories. Another is interpersonal style. These people are generally warm. They have a warm personality, conversational, friendship kind of oriented. I think of Matthew in the Bible, who invited his tax-collecting friends to come over to his house to meet Jesus. And then the invitational style. Again, we could all be about this, but many of you are hospitable, you're relational, and you're persuasive. Some of you invite people to come to church with you or come join us every week. All of us can do that. But some of you are really, really good at it. I think about the woman at the well who encountered Christ, and then she went back to tell others, and to Sychar. I think of Andrew, who led his brother to Jesus, just invited him to come and meet Jesus. And then finally, the serving style. This person is others-centered. They're humble, they're patient, they're caring. I think of Dorcas in the book of Acts. It says that she was always doing good and helping the poor. Many members in our church find themselves there. Well, here's what I want you to do. You can go online, make a note. You can look at this online. There's a quiz that we have where you can take a quiz and you can find out what your style is. And I think it's going to help open the door for you. I've taken the quiz recently and discovered again that really my style is more intellectual style, along with kind of a relational intellectual style. But I want you to join me to go deeper. If you want to come on Wednesday nights, I'm teaching a course for 3 weeks. You can come this Wednesday night and be a part of learning how to share your faith more effectively. But evangelism is a team sport. It's not like the pitchers on a baseball team where someone will start out the game and help guide a person to be inquisitive, interested in faith. Another person will come along like a lefty we need to bring in to throw a pitch against a right-handed hitter. And then some of you are closers. Some of you know that if you invite a friend to church to hear the gospel, perhaps you've done so today. I could serve as the closer, or some of our folks in a response area where we share the gospel and we can lead them to Christ. We can do it together. But these first two, the direct style, Peter, again, was the impetuous, ready kind of fire aim type personality. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 2, it says this. It's a good word for the direct person. Preach the word, be ready in season and out of season, reprove and rebuke and exhort with complete patience and teaching. Notice it says now to have patience and kindness, to be loving. But I'm curious, how many of you came to Christ through someone who had a direct approach? Maybe you heard someone just preach the gospel directly or speak directly to you and you came to faith in Christ. How many of you, raise your hand if you came to Christ that way. Yeah, many of you probably heard a message or a sermon and you were led to Christ right in that moment. Well, another style, the second one of the six, and we're just going to look at the two here real quick today, is intellectual style. Again, this is Paul. We see it in Acts 17. He was trained, educated under Gamaliel. He was one of the most educated men of his day. And he would reason and dialogue with others and help them break down barriers to faith in Christ. He was comfortable in doing that. Now, I love doing that. And some of you would think that's the last thing I want to do, is kind of get into debate or argument or just conversation, more likely, with someone who doesn't yet know Christ. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 15 says, but in your hearts, revere Christ as Lord. That is, live with Him as Lord. Lead with love. Always be prepared to give an answer to everyone who asks you to give the reason for the hope that you have. But do this with gentleness and respect. I'm curious, how many of you came to Christ because someone helped break down some barriers that you had to face, maybe some intellectual barriers? Anybody here? Some of you have, yes. Several of us have come to faith in Christ this way. You're going to see over the course of these next weeks, all of us came to faith in Christ through one of these styles, through someone who is simply being who God created them to be. And now it's your turn to do the same. I want each of us to discover how God's created us, and then I want us to be intentional in the days ahead. So here's what we're going to do. All of us are going to be praying throughout the coming days. We're going to pray for lost people who don't yet know the Lord in our lives. And I want you to be intentional. I imagine thousands of us praying daily for people that we could share Christ with. And then the Lord would prompt them, lay them on our hearts, and we'd have opportunity. You want to join the great adventure of the Christian faith? You decide that you're going to be an evangelist, a witness for Christ. Just be yourself. And God will use you. So we're going to pray. We've said we're going to pray for one person. We're going to pray at 1 o'clock every day. And we're going to pray for 1 minute for one person at 1 o'clock every single day. Now someone said, well, can I pray more than one person? No. No, you cannot. Yeah, I'm joking, right? Yes, pray. And God's going to lay more people on your heart. Would you pray for one? Would it be one person that you could pray for and invite to come and join us on Easter Sunday? Would it be someone that God would lay on your heart? I'm guessing if you do that, you're not even going to get to Easter. God's going to give you opportunity. So all of us are doing this. Our staff, all of us are joining in this. And then what we want you to do, this will be a lot of fun, as God leads you and as you experience encounters, just even a moment where you can be part of the link of the chain, we want you to call this number here. Write it down. We'd love you to call and just share your story. Leave a message and say, here's what God did in my life today. I got to share the gospel. I got to at least enter into a spiritual conversation with someone today. Just links in a chain. Can you imagine what it would be like to hear for the very first time? Well, many of us know what that's like because we came to faith in Christ and our lives were changed forever. Friend, you and I have the opportunity to be witnesses for Him and to be right there in that moment when one crosses the line from an eternity apart from Christ into an eternity with Him. Let us go as witnesses to the glorious gospel that God has given to us in Christ. Let's pray together. Lord, thank you for your word. Thank you for the practical teaching that comes to us from your word. I pray that every person here will be diligent now, not to simply hear a message, but to go now and to discover our style, how you've created us, and then use how you've created us to lead others to Christ. We want to be a part of the great adventure of sharing the gospel with others. Use us, Lord, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you for taking time to watch this sermon. If you would like more information about our church or following Jesus, please go to our website, pcbc.org, or contact our church offices. We hope to see you next week at church.